Only classic rock station Q104 with the Stones, Sir Mick.
Jeff this morning approved the sale of the New York Jets to Mr. Robert Wood Johnson, and I'm very pleased to advise you of that and to congratulate Mr. Johnson and to introduce him to you. Mr. Johnson, congratulations.
A new era for the New York Jets. Good
Mr.
morning.
Johnson,
Mike Green with Sports, NFL Commissioner. Paul Tagliabue with the announcement.
Quiche-sucking yuppie loser.
Fluoride Band-Aid.
Woody Goop. Johnson. Band-Aid heir, by the way.
Yeah.
The
God
new
almighty.
Owner
Thanks,
of the
Dad.
Jets.
Tactical
making a speech.
Powder.
And he took questions from the media.
Right.
The number one question, will Bill Parcells be his head coach?
Bill didn't say yes, he would coach. Put it that way.
No.
No. We're going to continue to hammer this out. One way or the other, to find out what role Bill wants to play in the team. And as I said, the bigger role he wants to play, the better.
Yeah. There you go.
Could you get me another butter?
Yeah.
It's all up to the champion.
God almighty.
Lord.
I mean, this is pathetic. This loser. Oh, God almighty. But he said he'll talk with Parcells one more time.
Great.
And was asked if he thinks he has a chance of changing Parcells' mind.
The kind of person Bill Parcells, the kind of general and leader Parcells is, I don't think Parcells is going to desert the Jets. That's my impression.
There you go.
Yeah, it's kind of generally is.
Oh, God almighty. I mean, you hate this guy already.
Oh, please. Oh,
this pretentious schmuck.
They're right back on track again.
God almighty.
My
and
God.
They sold, rather than sell it to that mobster, Charles Dolan, they sold it to this putz. God almighty, Woody Johnson.
I'm the commander-in-chief.
Yes. Well, you know, the kind of general that he is. Difficult to tell. I don't think he'll abandon the troops, do you? Kind of wonder if Kane's met him.
No.
Honest to God almighty. While the Jets still need a coach, the Packers have one. It's Mike Sherman, who's been an assistant for Mike Holmgren the past 3 years, one with Seattle, two with Green Bay. Sherman's setting some high standards.
Will I make mistakes? Yeah. Will my players make mistakes? Yep. But hopefully, we will win a bunch of football games in the process.
Supremely confident.
Oh, God almighty.
Hopefully.
Hello. Hopefully.
What is that?
Good grief.
The coach of the Packers, not the Saints.
Honest, I mean.
How about we will win a bunch of
football games? Oh, yeah, Brent Favre, or whatever his name is. You got him. Apparently got him off the Percocet or whatever he's on, a Vicodin.
I'll make mistakes. They'll make mistakes. Hopefully we'll win a few.
Damn well better.
They've already made a mistake by hiring this moron. Honest to God. College basketball, Bob Knight's Indiana Hoosiers meeting Steve Alford's Iowa Hawkeyes. Alford played for Knight. They won a national championship when he was a senior. But the past year, there appeared to be a rift between them. But they met for about 45 minutes before the tip-off yesterday. And afterwards, Knight the bully tried, of course, to blame the media for blowing it all out of proportion.
There are 10 other coaches there, and I had a chance to speak to a total of three.
So there's seven of them that I didn't speak to, didn't get a chance to speak to. And I'm tired of the bullshit that was made out of that, not speaking to one guy. If I've got a chance to speak to somebody, I speak to him.
Get over yourself. Get over yourself, you fat loudmouth. This is a, God, what a, one of the biggest creeps in sports.
Where is Latrell Sprewell?
Why doesn't Latrell Sprewell choke Bobby Knight?
To death.
God almighty. Well, I don't know about to death.
Well, to close to death.
Yeah. Blue.
Bobby Knight. Right. God, get over yourself, you fat loser.
Really?
And by the way, how about getting that program shaped up out there?
Yeah, you suck.
How about win a tournament game one of these years? How about not getting blown out of the NCAA in the first round? You're fat and you suck and you're over. God almighty, stop Bobby Knight, shut up.
Not the kind of general I would want.
Yeah, sweet, what's not to come?
I'll take a pass on him, thank you. Martini, please.
Well, he doesn't seem to me to be the kind of person who would abandon the troops.
Tisk, Bobby.
Where's that cheese? Over here. No.
God almighty.
Speaking of bullies, sports talk show hosts can be bullies. You can never get them to change their minds on anything. Listen to this example on WFAN in New York with host Joe Beningo, who stands his ground on his opinion here on a hockey matter despite the hard-fought attempts of a caller.
Okay, let's go to Russell in Huntington. You're on the Fan. Good morning, Russell.
Hey, how you doing, Joe?
I'm good, Russ. How are you?
I'm doing great. I want to talk about the Devils, and I want to know about what you thought about their chances in the playoffs.
Here's my biggest worry if you're a Devil fan. You know, Martin Brodeur, I have never seen this guy stand on his head and win a playoff game by himself. I have never seen that.
94 against Buffalo.
Okay, since then, have you seen him do it?
You got that one.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
All right, since then, Russell, name me another one. Name me two, in fact.
See, you can't do it.
No. Vinny, what do you got?
Doesn't take much.
God almighty. 94 against Buffalo.
Well, I was going to say that one, yeah.
I mean, besides that
right.
Well, that's a great cut. Who found that, Craig?
Oh, I was listening to that on the way in today.
Oh, man, that is, doesn't get any better than that, does it?
Hey, was your radio broke?
You listen to that on the way in?
Well, yeah, I always listen to the update to prepare me for my own sportscasts.
Loser!
God almighty, you have a CD player in your thing?
Yeah.
Well, turn it on.
Give a shout out to Mike Breen listening, driving in.
Sing to yourself.
Play that again. I love that. That's a great cut.
Okay, let's go to Russell in Huntington. You're on the Fan. Good morning, Russell.
Hey, how you doing, Joe?
I'm good, Russ. How are you?
I'm doing great.
Good.
I want to talk about the Devils, and I want to know about what you thought about their chances in the playoffs.
Here's my biggest worry if you're a Devil fan.
Okay.
You know, Martin Brodeur, I have never seen this guy stand on his head and win a playoff game by himself. I have never seen that.
94 against Buffalo.
Okay,
I'm a in the morning.
David, it's so...
Amos. Love, Bubba.
20 minutes.
Imus in the morning.
No. What are you doing? Idiot face, pay attention.
You said Seg
Breen. No, I didn't say. I said we'll take Walt Frazier and then Seg Breen, you little red-headed peckerneck.
No.
All right, here now, please.
Don't do this today.
Here now, Breen's broadcast partner on the Madison Square Garden television Knickerbocker games is Walt Clyde Frazier. Good morning, Mr. Frazier.
Yeah, the Knicks mugging and thugging. Sprewell devastating, asphyxiating in the paint. Yeah, the troll will curse and steal your mom's purse, but he ignites the D, filling Knicks fans with glee. Smoking and choking on the left side. I can't stop. I almost can't help myself.
Please, make an effort.
So I hear Breen's leaving, much to the Iron Man's chagrin.
Yeah.
Let's hope the Iron Man's devastation doesn't lead to another state of inebriation. Yeah, Madison Square Garden officials ecstatic over Breen's new status, citing his fatigue of late and his woeful performances in the broadcast booth, stumbling and mumbling at the microphone. Mike displaying a propensity towards density. Mike also recently doing a poor job braiding Sprewell's hair and massaging LJ's shoulders during pregame sessions. So Mike can ill afford to continue to wake up early for the I-Man.
Yeah.
But Mike always ubiquitous, precocious, promiscuous in the locker room. Oftentimes you hear someone shout, "What's Ewing doing?" And you hear back, "He's doing Breen in the latrine or behind the shower screen." Yeah, Mike pleasing the missing link by bending over the sink.
That'll be fine.
So Mike Breen, previously dividing his loyalty between the Knicks and the Iron Man, will now flee Imus for greener pastures. Mike taking his leave from the morning show to spend more time being Ewing's hoe. Good luck, Mike.
old Clyde Frazier.
Uh-huh.
Here on the, Imus in the Morning program. It is 18 till the hour.
Imus in the Morning. 2020 sports.
Left side, Francis still with a stutter step, 18-foot jumper. Two more! See Francis! Hold on his goal by the Blazers.
What can you say about this young kid?
Wow.
Steve Francis, boy, oh boy.
Unbelievable.
He is as exciting as they come in the league.
Portland loses on the road. Good morning. Mike Greenwood Sports, Gene Peterson, and Jim Foley talking at the same time on KPRC in Houston.
Rock Newman's guy, Steve Francis.
That's right.
Remember, it was Rock who gave us the information that Mr. Francis was leaving college early to turn pro, and that was an exclusive here. On the Imus in the Morning program, from a man, the Rock Man.
One of many sports exclusives.
Well,
the sportscast sponsored by the New Jersey Eye Center and Hackensack University Medical Center. Only the 10th loss of the season for Portland as the Rockets beat them 90-89, but that was not the upset of the night. The Miami Heat, Pat Riley's Miami Heat, Alonzo Mourning's Miami Heat, losing at home to the Chicago Bulls.
No, you can't. No,
oh,
they didn't.
Oh, my God. Happened in overtime last night. Here's Alonzo's take on the loss.
This one of the games you just look back on and say, damn.
The Heat's lead over the Knicks in the Atlantic Division, just one game. Knicks, meanwhile, play the Nets tonight. Knicks in a tough part of their schedule. A grueling stretch, according to Patrick Ewing.
I'm so tired right now.
But Ewing will be rested, certainly, for tonight's 7:30 tip-off.
You left now.
Football news, Robert Wood Johnson, officially named owner of the Jets yesterday.
God, this jerk.
Johnson, though, still needs a head coach. It appears it will not be Bill Parcells. Johnson, when he gets a coach in place, says he'll offer one piece of advice when they move to New York.
Watch your wallet.
So we tried to get a hold of Fred. We are trying to get a hold of Fred this morning.
Okay.
Out at the ranch to, on Breen's final day. Thought maybe Fred might have some sort of something to say to Breen, but
he's got time.
But Fred's unreachable, as is often the case.
Right.
That's unusual.
It's all right.
Green Bay Packers have a new coach. It's Mike Sherman, a former assistant coach for Holmgren, 1 year in Seattle, 2 years in Green Bay. Sherman got emotional yesterday when he stated he always dreamed of being the Packer head coach.
I thank God it's dream came true.
Speaking of the phone system out at the ranch. Oh, God, yes, this is just awful.
I've got more.
Oh, we'll let you get it in. You know, we are paying 42 cents a minute for long-distance AT&T.
Good Lord, interesting.
And so I said, gee, that seems like a lot. I see these ads where you can get like 8 or 10 cents a minute.
Exactly.
Said, well, yeah, all you have to do is ask and we'll give you that.
But as long as we can, we'll pitch you.
AT&T is a corporate sponsor of the Imus Ranch for Kids with Cancer. You know, they put up $250,000 to sponsor the horse barn, the AT&T horse barn.
What are they trying to do, recover it?
Unbelievable. Mike Breen, unfortunately, continues.
Baseball news, Yankees reportedly set to sign Derek Jeter to a 7-year, $119 million deal, which would be the richest in baseball history. And there are a number of baseball people who feel it's ridiculous to give anyone that kind of money. Jeter says anyone who says that doesn't have a clue about the game.
You know, they wouldn't know a baseball if they didn't know.
His annual salary would be $17 million.
We were now finally able to contact Fred Imus, who's been appearing on the program, sponsored by Jeep and Nikon, Mohegan Sun, for low these many years. As many years, certainly, as Breen has been on the program. Good morning, Fred.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
So I'm sitting back in the office this morning, Fred, around 5 o'clock Eastern time, no, about 5:30. And today is Breen's last day. Did you know that?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Here comes Breen.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, man.
And he walks in. I'm reading a paper. I'm already annoyed because Maureen Dowd has got just a loser column today about
Rouge.
Maureen and some girlfriend of hers went to buy wrinkle cream at Saks.
Please.
And I don't know what the point of the column was, but about liposuction and a bunch of other stuff. Anyway.
Uh-huh.
She says, so I'm already annoyed. Breen's standing there.
Sniveling.
Yeah. And he says, I said, what do you want? After I've reluctantly looked up. And Breen says, I have something serious. I said, okay.
Oh, here we go.
Don't embarrass him.
I'm not embarrassed.
Well, anyway, wanted to thank me, and I just said, get out, please. I'm begging you.
Really?
So I thought maybe you might have some thoughts.
Well, on you know, seriously, I love Mikey. I'm going to miss him.
You are?
Yeah, actually, I am. I mean, it's been on for years. I've enjoyed it.
Thank
I mean,
you,
he have to move on, and he's going to do well at whatever he does, you know, with the Knicks or football or whatever, but I'm going to...
Not football, friend. NBC doesn't have football.
Yeah, but he...
have ice dancing.
Ice dancing. Well, he'll do well with that, you know, the ice dancing and basketball, you know. But I have to... Seriously, I'm going to miss him.
You're going to break down, are you?
No.
Good Lord.
See, that's, what is going on?
That's what I was hoping from you. Had to get your panties on out there at the ranch?
No, but, you know, you have to be serious once in a while.
See?
You know?
Oh,
see?
God.
There you go. Well, bathhouse.
Thank you, Fred.
Come on.
Fred,
another
I love
one.
You, too.
Another
oh, my
one.
God.
Jeez.
Well, I like Breen, too. I love Breen. But, I mean...
Let's act like men here.
Yeah.
Great.
Men can be sensitive. Men can express their feelings and love. Just get out.
Get out or bend over.
Yeah, exactly. We have Warner Wolf. And Patrick McEnroe and Fred.
And he's got teeth, man.
Oh.
Maybe we could hire somebody with teeth this time.
Well, we have Patrick McEnroe. How about him?
I like Patrick.
I thought you liked him.
I do like him. But it's still, you know, I mean, it's okay to feel bad that Breen's leaving, you know, even though you have somebody to fill the job.
We don't feel bad.
Yeah, but it's okay if you do, and you should, you know.
Why?
Because otherwise... then, I don't know why, I can't articulate it very well.
Well said,
brother.
Man, oh man.
But you should feel, you should, because then the last 10 years mean nothing if you don't feel bad because he's leaving.
Well, what can't we
just
feel?
It's like getting attached to a dog, you know?
We don't have to swap spit and hug and...
Well, I mean,
we're not putting him to sleep.
Can't we feel good that he's leaving? I mean,
you can feel good that he's moving on to and probably to a better and brighter future, you know?
Oh, yeah, a lot better than appearing on this program. This is such an unsuccessful program.
Good,
15 million people listening on the radio, a couple million watching on TV. Yeah,
well, going good for
really, really sucks being on this program.
No, I'm just saying that that's not the point. The point is that he may be going on to something that he enjoys.
Oh, brother.
Fine.
Why don't you go beat a tom-tom and
yeah, why don't you go
somewhere.
Hug 20 of those trees? Instead of pulling on all those trees, why don't you go hug one of them?
I know what he's trying to say.
Well, I've never wanted to say this, Fred, and I promised Mom and Dad I wouldn't, but you were adopted. All right, well, I actually do share your sentiments about Breen. So.
Yeah.
Oh,
shut up.
That's the handkerchief.
Oh, no, get away from me. All right, thank you, Freddie.
You're welcome.
I love you.
Love you, Bob.
He loves you, too, Breen.
I love Fred.
Okay, that's great. God almighty.
I love you, man.
Type of looking at him.
Get him all.
Here's a message for all you people on the go. Let's say you're somewhere between Tuscaloosa, Alabama, in the middle of nowhere, and suddenly you want to access your email. You're out of luck, right? Not when you have the BlackBerry wireless handheld device and internet service from RCN. Together, they give you access to your email 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, from virtually anywhere in the United States. And best of all, you need only one email address for both your PC and BlackBerry. One address that you can access wherever you go. And with BlackBerry, not only can you access your account, you can send, forward, and reply to your email messages, too. So get the BlackBerry wireless handheld for one low monthly price, which includes unlimited RCN internet access. Then, whether you find yourself in Walla Walla, Washington, or if you're simply stuck in traffic, you'll be glad you have BlackBerry in your pocket. Just call 1-800-RING-RCN to sign up. 1-800-RING-RCN. Call today. This offer won't last forever. 1-800-RING-RCN. If you
were... The time would never come, but the mountain finally came to Muhammad. Muhammad being yours truly, the mountain that Adirondack-assed Hillary Clinton. After much hemming, hawing, and waiting for the perfect politically exploitable moment, the bold butt bimbo finally deemed fit to take a meeting with me on Martin Luther King Day. Nothing nothing like tainting the memory of the patron saint of racial equality by using his birthday as an opportunity to appeal to African-American voters. Now, I have seen some pandering in my life, but never have I been witness to such a hands-down, ass-up, knee-drop suck job as the one she displayed the other day. She shared a childhood memory of meeting Dr. King that had a cringe factor so high it was almost off the chart on the insincerity meter. And I've heard beauty pageant contestants sound more intelligent articulating their plans for world peace. According to her speech, an audience with Dr. King inspired Hillary to dedicate herself to public service. No wonder we had such a hard time getting his birthday named a holiday. He's responsible for this pant load in the pantsuit making her Senate bid. Not only is she exploiting his memory, she's besmirching it. Martin Luther King had a dream. This bitch is a nightmare. Now I understand why, after her appearance on his show, David Letterman had to go in for a quintuple bypass. Between the fat in her ass and the fat in her head, he's lucky all his damn arteries weren't clogged. Am I to believe it was a handshake from MLK that inspired HRC to seek political office? I always assumed it was the BJ that BC got in the Oval Office. But even Monica didn't go down on Bubba the way Hillary went down on the black voting community. Of course, you can't blame the girl, seeing as how all those years she'd been married to that jerk with the junior Jimmy Jammy, it was understandable why she would prefer the black and down with fun. Ultimately, however, Hillary may have done more harm than good for her campaign. Following her appearances in Harlem, she met with the family of Amadou Diallo, the unarmed African immigrant killed by four white police officers in the Bronx. 10 minutes into that particular meeting, and the Diallos were ready to campaign for Rudy Giuliani. I had all I could do to keep Mr. Diallo from grabbing a plunger and going at the First Lady Abner Louima style. Although if he really wanted to make a dent in her ass, he would have needed something a whole lot bigger than a plumber's helper.
Postgraduate days. Both of us obsessed with me becoming the president of the USA. After graduation, we got married and I was governor of Arkansas. I was porking every single bimbo in the county while she worked for Rose Law. Well, it wasn't there. Would die. Goodbye. Hey, wedding place. Take these daughters for me. Hill.
This daughter's name.
Why don't you lie down and sleep? Hill. Is it getting dark? Say hi to Vince in the park. Hill. By your man, and she held my hand while I brought shame to my name and cried and denied that I had ever lied and claimed I wasn't to blame. That it was payback time as Hillary whined about all the humble pie she did eat. Made me promise that I would get behind her in a run for a Senate seat. Cause there's a moving truck here to move her stuff up to Chappaqua. Can't believe my luck. I'm don't have to kill my wife after all, 'cause Hillary said goodbye.
Na, 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 na.
Possibility of ever appearing on this program were minimal. Wouldn't you? Well, this is unfortunate. Bad to the bone, baby. My son.
On the day I was born, the nurses all gathered round. And they gazed in wide wonder at the joy they had found. The head nurse spoke up. Said, leave this one alone. She could tell right away that I was bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad to the bone. Bad. 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 Bad to the bone.
I miss in the morning.
Mohegan Sun ringing in the new year by giving away a car a day each and every day of this week.
Bob Dole says you're tingly feeling down in Bob Dole's wiener. Bob Dole doesn't need that Viagra. Here's Warner Wolf, or whatever.
Good morning, Warner.
Good morning. Thank you, my man. The Simus in the Morning Sports Report is brought to you by Cosmo.com.
What?
The Cosmo.com. The internet delivery service that delivers to homes or offices in Manhattan. On the web at KOZMO.com. Well, you can't fool those Wiz fans. Despite Michael Jordan becoming part owner and head of operations, only 10,000 showed up at the 20,000 MCI Center last night to see the Wiz lose by 18 to the Mavericks. Earlier, Jordan on taking over the Wiz.
Do we have a championship quality team? You know, I don't know. It's yet to be seen.
Yet to be seen? You got to be kidding. What a crummy ball club. And here's the question. How is a superstar like Jordan going to relate to the second worst team in the East and with three of the most overpriced, overrated players in the league? That's Juwan Howard, Rod Strickland, and Mitch Richmond.
Well, I don't know.
At halftime, the Wiz passed out T-shirts.
Hope these are rhetorical questions.
They are.
They are.
Oh, you can join in, I mean.
That's okay. Sure.
At halftime, the Wiz passed out T-shirts. It said, New Year, New Day, we've got MJ. It should have said, New Year, New Day, we've got MJ, but he can't play. Who are they kidding? This is the same old Wiz with a new owner.
Yeah, an ugly situation. Yeah.
Horrible.
Else they could get better.
Well, it's unlikely they would get worse.
Yeah.
This club is terrible.
Yeah.
And overpaid.
Right. Well.
And now he has to shell out the money.
That's it.
You think he's, hey, this is coming out of my pocket now.
Well,
Michael Jordan.
We can address these issues.
That's right. As they occur. With your private sources.
Hopefully we can drop it on the sportscast.
Elsewhere last night, the Knicks blew... Bring back Breen! Elsewhere last night, the Knicks blew a 12-point lead in the fourth quarter, then came back and beat the Nets 90-89. The Nets had a chance to win with 6 seconds left. Marv Albert of WFAN.
Burrell can't find anybody. Now gets it into Marbury. 5 seconds. Marbury on the move. Penetrates and loses control of the ball. Taken by Houston and the buzzer sounds.
After the game, Marbury, who couldn't get off a shot.
Very frustrating. It's very frustrating. We got to keep playing. We got a game tomorrow. This game is history.
It's history because you couldn't get a shot
That's
off.
That's right. Throw it up there. For
Jeez,
God.
Shoot the ball.
Shoot. Get rid of it.
Take it. Come on.
Take the shot.
Either that or play for the Wiz.
That's all.
The Lakers were the best record in the NBA. The I-Man's Lakers made it 18 of 20.
Wow.
Beat Cleveland 95-86. The Shaq,
27 points, 23 boards, and 5 out of 13 from the foul line.
Man's on fire.
If Jeff Wilkins is unable to kick for the Rams Sunday, the Rams have told 43-year-old Nick Lowry to be ready.
Ready, Nick.
Lowry hasn't kicked since 1996.
Okay. So he's rested. Okay. Well rested. Suit up, baby. Suit up.
That's right. His leg is ready.
His leg is ready. He's well rested.
He's due.
Good to go.
Which goalpost do I kick at? Where is it? Can Lou Groza be far behind?
Possibly not.
No.
By the way, you could have had the Rams at 200-1, I man, before the season started.
Right, yeah.
The word is Ray Rhodes will replace Mike Nolan, who resigned yesterday as Redskins coordinator. If Derek Jeter does become the highest paid player in the league, of course you have Ken Griffey and Alex Rodriguez haven't signed yet, at $17 million for 7 years, Jeter would earn $95,000 per game.
Good Lord.
Or a little over $10,000 per inning.
Wow.
What?
$10,000 per inning. That's more than the entire Black Sox scandal players got for throwing the whole series in 1990.
Good grief.
Well, I'm going to shoot you one.
I don't think
Finally,
so.
Talk about a fatalistic attitude.
What happened?
The English tabloid, The Mirror, has paid 35-year-old Julius Francis, who fights Mike Tyson, January 29th, $33,000 to put the paper's logo on the bottom of Francis's shoes. So every time Francis goes down, people will see the Mirror logo.
That's not good.
That's unbelievable.
That is unbelievable, isn't it?
I love that.
I do like that song.
You like that?
Yeah. 8 minutes down to the hour here in the Anderson. Bring him on a wolf here.
You heard the hype.
Me? No hype. I got a horse's head in my pants.
The critically acclaimed series returns, but will it measure up?
Hey, that ain't a little dick joke, is it?
The Hope Bronos.
Did you see my wife on Letterman, huh? Top 10 list? She should have done a stupid pet trick. F***ing dog that she is.
Deception, betrayal, murder. Just a typical day at the White House.
Funny how right after she was such an embarrassment on national TV, Dave came down with that heart trouble, huh?
In this world, don't ask, don't tell has many meanings.
This McCain guy's getting heat because he knows if somebody's gay just by their behavior and attitude. Why? Like that ain't true.
How can he tell? Don't ask.
You see a man wearing fuchsia hot pants singing Sondheim tunes, it's a pretty safe bet he's working the other side of the anti-posh. Know what I'm saying? A guy don't have to have a dick in his mouth for me to know he's a mo.
Yeah, that'll be quite enough.
They like them bad people. I've had a few of them on my crew, but I didn't need for the gerbil to pop out to spot them.
Rosie O'Donnell is Hillary Clinton.
That's typecasting.
Gene Hackman is Senator McCain.
It takes a man's man to know when another man is a woman.
Richard Kinky, Big Dick Friedman, is Consigliere James Carville.
They don't call him Serpent Head for nothing.
And James Gandolfini is Billy Little Dick Hope Frano.
Hey, don't spread that linguini-weenie stuff around, will you? I don't want to be remembered as going off all half-cocked, you know what I mean?
What's the matter?
You wuss!
Why?
I used to respect you.
Why?
She's doing a report. You pick up the phone and call your wife.
No. We don't need to talk about this on the air.
And he goes, Charles, did you hear this?
No.
Hey, Kiki.
Kiki.
You're
lying. You're an old homo.
I sit here and hear it daily for about 4 or 5 times every time he calls.
You're lying.
Embarrassing. I like the doctor. I love my wife.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
She's
man.
Wonderful, but come on.
I am a man.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Call her up to tell her what you want for lunch when you get home, for crying out loud.
Absolutely.
Well, I can do that.
No, you can't.
You could, but you don't.
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to I Miss in the Morning.
Hello?
Honey?
Yes?
It's your husband.
Hi, honey.
I'll have a hamburger when I get home.
Oh, right.
I'll have a hamburger, a couple hamburgers well done, and some melted cheese on it, and a beer, okay?
What, are you drinking again?
Up next at the mic is...
Want some whiskey and you want a sugar in your tea? What's all these crazy questions they're asking me? This is the craziest party that could ever be. Don't turn on lights, cause I don't want to see.
I'm not told in the sky.
the Imus in the Morning radio program. On WFAN New York and Infinity Broadcasting Station, 7 o'clock, time for Imus in the Morning news. Local developments include the weather. Now snowing in New York City, where perhaps up to 4 inches of snow is expected today. The snow expected to cause difficulties during the morning and evening rush periods. Snowfall expected to grow heavier as the day goes on. And the heaviest snowfall is expected along the coast, particularly out in Suffolk County, also northwest of the city, where perhaps up to a half foot or better of snow may accumulate. And then once all of that passes by, a big frigid air mass is right behind, expected to return to the region, driven by strong winds, blustery day tomorrow, and then dangerously low wind chills are expected all day tomorrow because of the winds. So, as the area braces for today's snowstorm, a Queens family is mourning 75-year-old Mary Variali.
What do you mean you were going to tell me that the storm was explosive?
I said that was a descriptive word that I heard used on a forecast this morning, that's all.
The
Atlantic coastal storm that is churning its way up.
Well, okay, I'm not going to go get on an iJet and fly anywhere then. I'm not going to go to Norfolk or anyplace else. What does the weather forecast say? Doesn't it say severe weather bulletin?
Yeah. It's just a discussion of the conditions I'm
What
in.
Are they?
Well, an inch per hour.
What are they?
Snowfall rates expected to develop over, up and down the coast through 1800 Zulu.
6 o'clock tonight.
Yeah. Spreading all, it's a big storm. It's a big storm. What can I tell you? It's a big storm. There's one coming in from the west. There's one coming up the coast from the...
We are supposed to broadcast in this big talk fest. Big deal down at the Chesapeake Conference Center tomorrow in Norfolk, Virginia. On our very fine affiliate there in Norfolk, WTAR at 850 on the dial, with Senator John McCain, Jeff Greenfield, former Governor George Allen, Chris Collinsworth from Fox Sports, and Jonathan Alter from Newsweek.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not going to go if it's... Well, I have no intention of going if there's any kind of icky weather at all.
Well, I
get a hold of Colucci out there at Executive Jet and see what he knows.
Right. Get to the bottom of this, man.
Here's Margaret Carlson from Time Magazine. Good morning, Miss Carlson.
Good morning, Don.
Where are you?
I'm in my kitchen looking at the snow falling.
And you're in D.C., right?
Mm-hmm.
66 is the number. Russ Salzberg and Jordan McDonald here. Sports Radio 66. FAN New York.
Mike and the Mad Dogs Big Game Football Trivia gives you a chance to see pro football's big game on Sunday, January 30th in Atlanta. You'll have another chance to win today between 1 and 6 p.m. exclusively on The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
Howard has the market cornered on spanking lesbians.
Yeah.
And he lives in a $6 million apartment. Stern replaced Jay Thomas on K-Rock, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
The I-Man is flying his kid on a iJet above the fray. These guys take themselves very seriously. I just want to talk to the guy who rides the subway. If the ratings come in, I'll be hysterical. If your ratings come in, I'll eat your microphone.
We'll all be hysterical.
We'll all be hysterical. And if they do come in, it'll be because they got their music rotation straightened out over there at Jammin' 105 so they don't suck. They get their ass kicked by CBS-FM.
That's
what will happen there. Jay Thomas, God almighty. I mean, you go through your life, and you can't ever escape these people. There's always there this sniping at you.
Yeah.
God.
Coming back in.
Just unbelievable. That's a total, complete, absolute, abject loser.
He's been living on a subway.
Sure. I'm in on the iJet.
Yeah,
eat me. Almighty, drop dead.
Just you.
F you. You loser, you washed-up loser. God almighty.
Jay Thomas, is that over?
God almighty, is that over?
Get in front of
I
us.
Mean, when you get lie down in front of one of those subway
exactly.
trains. Honest to God.
And good morning.
Jammin' 105. Motown. Get the hell out of here. Here's Steve from Shirley, Massachusetts on line one. Good morning, Steve.
Good morning, I-Man.
How are you?
Pretty good. I sent you a tape this past week. I don't know whether you heard it or not, but...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, did you hear it?
Oh, yeah, we all sat in the office and listened
to it.
Pretty good.
Yeah, well,
great.
Whatever.
No, we didn't hear any tape.
What are you, nuts? Well, okay, I thought I'd give it a shot purposes.
What was the tape for?
Well, the tape was to, do comedy sports routines.
Oh.
Yeah. So
Why wasn't this brought to my attention, Bernard?
Must be an oversight.
Well, I said to Bernard, I'd do a Warner imitation for you over the air.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Warner Wolf.
Hey, let's hear it.
Let's hear it.
Okay. Sure. Thank you. Good morning, I-Man. If you had the New York Knicks in 20...
That's why you didn't hear it.
Here's the problem. There was an article in, I think it was the New York Times. Yes, it was the New York Times. About people who are incompetent. Who have no idea that they are, you know. And in fact, people who are most incompetent think that they are the
most competent.
For example, like Jay Thomas. Now, here's a guy who thinks that he is a happening. He's never been happening, ever.
No.
Didn't he have some role on Murphy Brown or something?
Right.
He was awful on that.
Yeah. About 5 minutes. About 5 minutes,
wow.
Yeah.
But and particularly show business is full of people, actors and singers and disc jockeys and whomever. Singers, you know, all of them.
Certainly.
Who
of
think
course.
That they can't
oh,
understand why they
please.
Can't understand why they're not happening.
Certainly.
Well, they're not happening. I mean, they're not happening because, like this guy, they suck. My impression of Warner Wolf.
He thought that was good. That was entertaining.
Yeah.
Hey, I'll call Imus.
Send you a tape. You know, we did have a guy one time who called and did a Marv Albert impression, who was some fisherman or something, right?
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That guy was fabulous. Remember him?
Oh, sure.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, that guy was good.
He had it nailed. It was funny to boot.
It was Marv. Anyway, well, speaking of Warner Wolf, here we go.
Good morning, Greasy. We say I must say in the morning, 2020 sports, with a stupid, lazy, inferior American sportscaster, Warner Wolf.
Good morning, Warner.
Good morning. Thank you, my man. The Simus in the Morning Sports Report is brought to you by Hackensack University Medical Center.
All right,
my man, let's get right to it. The two playoff games. Here we go.
All right.
The Rams average 30 points a game.
Right.
Tampa can't score.
No.
It's as simple as that.
Yeah.
A no-brainer.
Yeah.
Rams 31,
Tampa
13. I got 10.
Well, that was you held up a card last night on TV on Channel 2 that said...
Right. 30.
Said 30 to 10?
31 to 10.
That's what you held up?
Yes.
Well, one of me held up said 13. Is that the next game?
That's the next game.
Okay,
that's
go
right.
Ahead.
Very good, I-Man. In the next game, the Titans. Keep in mind, they beat Jacksonville twice in the regular season.
Right,
it is extremely difficult to beat a good team three times in the same season.
You know, I heard this exact same rhetoric on Channel 2 last night with you doing sports. I turn on Channel 2. It's about 20 minutes after 6 Eastern time to see you do the sports, and then I turn back to wherever, whatever I was watching because I can't take the rest of it, but I love your sports deal. You know who else is good on your radio, on your TV station is... what do they do?
Male? Female?
The woman's on at 5 o'clock. Does the news.
Mulatto
What's her name?
Girl?
Lisa Cooley?
No.
Dana Tyler.
She's great.
Yeah. Yep.
She's great and you're great.
Thank you.
But the rest of them don't have any energy. I don't understand that. I mean, they're okay, I guess, but they need...
Goose it up a little.
Yeah, they need to. I mean, Warner lights the screen up.
Absolutely.
That is a pancake.
I mean, I'm not saying that just because Warner's here, but I mean, Warner's great. You know, you can see, by the way, on the satellite around the country, if you get it, you can actually see Warner on Channel 2 out of New York. Anyway, I'm sorry, Warner.
That's all right, I-Man.
But I've heard all this, but go ahead.
Wow. I try it out.
You didn't hear it.
I try it out like in New Haven. See, it's like showbiz. If it works, then I'm bringing it here.
Okay.
See, that's the way.
What indication did you get that it worked, by the way?
Well,
he didn't get fired last
night. That's right.
Somebody didn't come and drag him off the set.
They didn't turn the mic off.
He just turned the camera off. Right.
He didn't take his teeth out of his mouth.
Good one, Warner.
All right, go ahead, Warner.
And keep in mind, the Jacksonville defense allowed only 13 points a game.
Well, that's right.
So it's the Jags 24, the Titans 13.
Oh, okay.
Got it.
How much is a fine worth for squirting an NFL official with a water bottle?
I don't know.
$40,000.
$40,000 is right. That's exactly right.
Wow.
On the nose. Of all the figures to pick. That's right. Not 39.5.
No.
No.
Not 41.2.
No.
But these guys.
Well, I think. I mean, and he's choking him?
If they had disciplined O.J. early on in his career, maybe he would never would have slain two people.
Oh, Jesus, God almighty.
It's a slippery slope.
The Warner continues.
That's an interesting theory.
Mike Tyson. Mike Tyson.
Discipline, baby.
Think about it.
Mike Tyson seems to be doing his best to alienate himself in England,
yeah,
where he fights Julius Francis.
Well, he's not trying to alienate himself. He's trying to alienate others from him.
That's right.
From him.
What happens?
Destroy him. Oh, heck, I'm losing my teeth.
Thanks, Professor. First, Tyson insulted a group of women protesting his presence in England.
Yeah.
Then he made crude comments about the women's husband.
Well,
then he now faces a $320 fine for jogging in Hyde Park at 3 a.m.
Well,
says Tyson, I'm not appreciated in the United States because America is not developed or sophisticated enough. While Europe has been around since Attila the Hun.
I'm surprised he didn't even heard of the guy.
God almighty. Unbelievable.
NBA last night, the Nets blew a 17-point third-quarter lead, came back, beat the Pistons 122-120. 34 points for Stephon Marbury.
We've been playing well throughout this last past week. We just didn't come up with the wins.
Well, okay. That's all that counts.
Sure.
The win.
I hear you.
Charlotte over the Sixers. Allen Iverson took 89 shots at 35 points. Houston over the Rockets. Kings 7 in a row beat Orlando. The Sonics also 7 in a row beat the Bucks. After the game, Bucks coach George Karl.
And I wish, I'll be honest with you, I wish I had more guts to bench some of the big three. Because I don't think they're taking the responsibility they should take.
Oh, wait a minute. Why? He's the coach. Why can't he bench you?
Certainly. Set him down.
What do you mean he has no guts?
He's the guy.
Well, WTAI in Norfolk, Virginia this morning at 8:50 on Al Talk and Sports Radio, and they're broadcasting from the, having a big day, big talk fest deal, broadcasting from the Chesapeake Conference Center. And coming up at 10 o'clock this morning, there, live in person, will be Tony McCreaney. Is that the way you pronounce the guy's name?
Yep.
2 hours of power from 10 to noon. Tony,
all right.
Tony will be holding for it there.
Excellent.
And then Andre, how do you pronounce his last name? Viet? Viet? V-I-E-T-T-E, Charles.
Viet.
Viet.
Well, it might be.
I'm guessing.
Andre Viet in the Garden. He's doing something from noon to three. And then the Black Avenger, Ken Hamblin.
All right.
Will be on this afternoon. So they'll be there all day at the Chesapeake Conference Center, so y'all plan to stop by. Yeah. Warner continues.
Elsewhere, the 33-7 Lakers, with Shaq Fu and Kobe Dooby-Doo, did not play.
No.
But the Shaq missed 10 foul shots.
Oh, man.
Australian Open, number one seed Pete Sampras lost the first two sets.
What?
He lost the first two sets to unknown Wayne Black, a household name only in his own household.
Sure.
7-6, 6-3, and then came back and won the next three sets and the match 6-3, 7-5, 6-3.
All right, Pete.
Sampras is now 8-0 in five-set career matches at the Australian Open.
Wow.
Other winners, Lindsay Davenport, Mary Pierce, and Anna Kournikova.
Yeah. All righty. Serena didn't play, or?
Serena played yesterday.
I want her to win.
She did win.
I want her to whoop up on Martina Hingis in the final.
She did.
Whoop it up.
You know what? She's a real person. She blew an overhead smash and stopped and put her hand over her face.
No.
She didn't get mad or anything. And then won the set.
Okay, well,
she is better than her sister.
Yeah, she is better.
Yeah.
All right, Warner Wolf here on the Amish Morning Program. It's 10 minutes till the hour. Coming up is Senator John McCain. Then we'll talk with former Virginia Governor George Allen, who's running for the Senate there.
Mm-hmm.
I guess who's he running against? Chuck Robb?
Yep.
Well, we obviously are for George Allen.
Mm-hmm.
Totally. God. And then Jeff Greenfield from Time Magazine and CNN, he'll be on it. And Chris Collinsworth from Fox Sports, he'll be
great,
on it.
Great.
And Fred will be on this morning.
Oh, please. Check it out.
Plus a hilarious version of I Miss Washington that even my brother commented about yesterday. Mm-hmm. And also, Reverend Al Sharpton. So it's a great show today.
I Miss in the Morning.
All right.
Well, on the heels of the snow now, we have this intense cold spell. Windchill advisory for today. It's not going to be out of the 20s, but this, with these blustery winds around, it's going to feel like anywhere from 10, 20, maybe 30 degrees below zero when you factor in the wind chill.
Buy a coat.
That's all. Storm is headed out to sea, you know, but it's left. Yeah.
I took a bunch of those drifter jackets, prototypes that I'd gotten.
Uh-huh.
And we took them over to the Salvation Army. They're warm jackets.
Oh, absolutely.
So
yeah.
This is the time of year, by the way, to donate old clothes and stuff to these homeless shelters and
yep.
stuff. And Brant took a couple of huge leaf bags of clothes that I got out of my closet, jackets and stuff mm-hmm. like that, over to the Salvation Army. So, and I went into my closet, and it took about 30 minutes. It didn't even take that long to get all this stuff, and it's easy to do.
Sure.
And well, now's a great time of year to do it.
You betcha.
Wait, yep. You can go in there and you find stuff you haven't worn in years.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have any of that stuff anymore. I used to have shirts that I had were 30 years old. I don't have them anymore.
Gloves and stuff?
No, get rid of them.
Yeah, yeah.
Give them to these people. So, anyway, what else?
Excellent idea. Well, just the weather. Sunny and very windy today. Mid-20s, wind chills 20 below. Mostly clear tonight, down into the single digits near zero in the suburbs. Tomorrow, mostly sunny, the high 25. And maybe another chance of snow late in the day Sunday.
Fine.
Excuse me?
Fine.
19 above right now at 3 minutes after the hour.
Okay, room.
First here in Washington, in the wake of the court document disclosure that the President of the United States has a bug dick, news from the White House that Mr. Clinton's organ donor card has been revoked. Mr. Clinton made a statement on the matter a short time ago. Double IW microphones were there.
Hey, babe, you want to go out?
Hang on a second, babe. Now, I'm going to say this, and I'm only going to say it one time. Penises don't grow on trees. Just because some bastard with a book had to reveal that I got a quarter-round piccolo pecker don't mean that I ought to have to suffer this additional indignation of having my organ donor card yet. I feel certain, and Carver will back me up on this, that my penis, while diminutive, has value and can still make a contribution. My fellow Americans, it is the official view of this White House that whether 15 inches or 5, an erection is a terrible thing to waste. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Come here, Daddy. You look so good.
Keep looking, baby. He's down there somewhere.
Meantime, in an interview with a Buffalo, New York television station, First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton has said she wants to poor word choice. She wants to put rumors to rest that once her husband leaves the White House, the two of them will divorce. Mrs. Clinton notes that the couple has been together for 25 years and that Mr. Clinton's, as she put it, clothespin pecker has been a constant source of amusement for her, and she sees no reason to end the yucks now.
On the campaign trail, still trying to backtrack after telling reporters he could spot gay people in a crowd just by the way they act, Arizona Senator John McCain actually seemed to intensify the controversy today when he added that in addition to gays, he could also, with great accuracy, pick Negroes out of a crowd. Here's a portion of the senator's offhand remarks made chatting with reporters on his campaign bus.
Now, I'll give you that you can't always be sure about your mo every time, but I'm 9 out of 10 on your black, you know what I mean? And Chinaman, hell, it's easy. Of course, your Latins can fool you sometimes. Like that Ricky Martin. What the hell kind of a Mexican name is Martin? And you'll never fool me on one of those India dudes because they stick this red dot deal right here in the middle of their f***ing foreheads. How do you miss that? Of course, if they're also a Mo, well, hell, then you're right back where you started, aren't you, sweetheart?
Meantime, the front runner in the Republican race, George Bush Jr., appeared to raise new questions about the range and depth of his knowledge today when he had to be prompted by aides regarding the identities of close relatives. Double IW microphones were nearby during one particularly embarrassing campaign stop as a constituent inquired about the health of the candidate's famous mother.
How's your mother, Governor?
Who's that?
The gentleman inquires about your mother, Governor.
Oh, yeah, of course, sir. Yeah, sure. My mother.
Your mom, fluffy white hair,
yeah.
Bug eyes.
Oh, yeah, bug eyes. I remember that.
Catcher's mitt face.
Yeah, they're all right. Damn, I can just picture her now.
Yes.
What is her name?
Starts with a B, sir.
Right. Betty. Beverly.
Barbara. That's it. You nailed it, sir.
Yeah, Barbara Boxer is my mom.
Oh, we're dead. Get back on the bus, sir. God almighty, what a dumb sumbitch. Hey, I wouldn't even vote for her.
Some good news for GOP long shot candidate Alan Keyes. As the movement is reported growing exponentially, launched by people at a grassroots level who are promising they'll vote for him if he'll just shut the f***
And finally, the bid by Senator Orrin Hatch for the attention of the GOP electorate continues to dwindle, it appears. Just how thin the Hatch appeal has become seemed to be underscored today when the senator was spotted in a Manchester, New Hampshire hotel lobby utterly alone, holding a small piece of cardboard in front of him that bore the crudely printed message, "We'll explain tax plan for food."
Of course, you couldn't even make up what the senator's actually doing, Orrin Hatch. He's going around reading a letter that he got from Pierre Salinger. even McCord didn't look like a lad.
No, I would not.
The I'm the Morning Business Report is sponsored by the New York Stock Exchange. You can learn...
In the Huddle, coming up. I'll take it 8 on that show. So we'll get Boomer with us. Nice job out of Joe and Jim today, and Christopher Carlin, Phil Sims, of course, great job. John McClain on the 4th goal. Don't forget, tomorrow morning at 10. Mike, we'll see you Sunday at 9. And we'll see you in the Huddle in a few minutes. Adios.
We are talking with Senator John McCain because I've endorsed you, and at this point, while we're still very...
At this point. Got that? The magic words, well, Charles. The magic senator, words at this point.
Remember old Bob Dole?
No.
Maybe it's your attire this morning has turned you into a sissy.
I am prepared to take a hit in Iowa for McCain, but we have to win New Hampshire. We don't win New Hampshire.
His own. Adios.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
I was talking with Orrin Hatch. He said, I have a lot of respect for John, but there's some things I can't stand about him. Why? Well, what is that all about?
I really don't know. I've told him he's on my short list for Postmaster General. He should be happy. Imus in the
Morning on the Fan Voice Radio 66 WFAN. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good evening. It's 6 o'clock. I'm Joe Tolleson. The NFL has made a decision in the dispute between...
Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
Okay, let's turn our attention to tomorrow where we have... 24.
Listen to Salzburg and Summers from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m., right after Imus in the Morning, and just before Mike and the Mad Dog in the afternoon, here on The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
A little concerned by that myself. If I'm a Ram fan, the whole world thinks you're going to blow out Tampa tomorrow, and that would concern me. It really would a little bit. 11 o'clock, Mink's coming up, we're coming back. Sports Radio 66.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting Station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning at 11 o'clock. This is John Minko out of Jet Camp. The indications are it's status quo. Bill Barcells reiterating to...
UConn game, huh?
Yes, I do.
On Westwood 1.
Yes, I do.
And the game, that's a good game on Monday night.
It should be.
Who are you doing a game with?
Larry Conley.
He's a good guy.
Yeah, well, I've never met him, but I will Monday night.
He's a good broadcaster.
Absolutely.
Played with Riley down at...
Kentucky.
Dampier for Adolph Rupp. He was on the 66 team.
Yeah.
Well, that's a good job, Mink. When are you flying up to Syracuse?
Tomorrow.
You mean going first thing in the morning so you get to watch the games?
No, I'll be working here tomorrow morning.
So when are you flying up there?
I will miss...
Tomorrow night, then.
No, I will miss some of the AFC game, yes, I will.
What time is your flight?
At 2 o'clock.
What do you mean, some of the game? I mean, what do you mean?
Well, the game starts at 12:30.
You're going to miss the whole game.
No, I'm not.
Well, from what airport?
It's only an hour.
What airport?
I'm only going to Syracuse. I'm not going to Vancouver.
Airport?
LaGuardia.
What time are you arriving in Syracuse?
3:30.
You're going to miss the whole game.
No, I'm not.
You're missing the AFC champion. I don't blame you, but you're going to miss the title game.
I am not going to miss the title game.
Well, how are you going to watch it, Mink? The game is at 12:30.
Well,
you're going to be on a plane at 2.
I don't know. Maybe they'll
tell me how you're watching the game.
Pumping in the speakers up in the plane. Should I drive?
No, you have to watch. You have to do the game. You could go on. You could go Monday night, Monday morning, first thing.
Yeah, but
that's
weather,
a little risky.
That's a little risky. Yeah.
You could go tomorrow night. Why not?
That's a little risky, too.
Well, I mean, planes fly at night, Mink. What do you mean,
risky? I understand that, but...
You drive at night? Why can't planes
but
fly
the
at night?
The weather is iffy. Here and there. And the
Mink,
planes,
you're an old man. I'll tell you, you are an old... You're an old man.
And the plane's a prop.
Give me these... Give me... All right, Chin, take it easy. Give me the weather or something, Mink. Oh, driving me crazy.
I already gave you the weather. I told you it was 14 degrees and minus 9 wind chill. I just tell you that we are your home for tomorrow's NFC and AFC Championship games at 12:15.
Back on a fan hour two of our radio program. Nice to have you with us on this Saturday morning at 718-937-6666. You know, I got to say something about the Mets. You know, what are the Mets doing here with all these left-handed pitchers? And it's not like they're bringing in quality guy, you know, Rich Rodriguez. I had one goal from a Giants standpoint at the end of the season. I wanted three guys off the team. Two I did not want re-signed as free agents. And the third, I want to trade it. I did not think I was going to get the third thing done with the trade. I wanted Tavares out, gone. Somehow Dan O'Dowd gave him $1.2 million to go pitch to the Rockies. Asinine. I wanted Jerry Spradlin traded. Somehow they got... I just let everyone know someone who has...
Every 20 minutes, this is John Minko, WFAN 20, 20 Sports.
Next week, it's Super Bowl 34. But tomorrow... It's the AFC and NFC Championship games as Jacksonville hosts Tennessee and Tampa Bay visits St. Louis. Our doubleheader coverage begins at 12:15 right here on The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
You got to have them at least around. Not in front of 12, Sports Radio 66.
New York Sports Talk and New York Sports. And it's only on one radio station. The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York. I'm here with John.
Kansas City. Two, Schottenheimer's going to want $3.5 million of the year. $3.5 million a year. Maybe Woody Johnson doesn't want to pay him $3.5 million a year. Grow comes cheap. Three, you have a whole new staff with Marty. At least with Grow, you keep some of these coaches around. An effective, good staff. Noontime. Marvin Lewis, the Ravens defensive coordinator, will join us when we come back. Talk about the AFC Championship game. John Fox is up with the NFC. We'll do that in a sec following Ackerman's Flash or update, Sports Radio 66.
WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good afternoon at 12 noon. This is Rich Ackerman, the news. Tonight, cloudy with a chance of snow late and a low around 20. For tomorrow, occasional light snow accumulations of an inch or two and a high only around 30. It is 16 degrees right now in Central Park, and that's what's happening. This is Rich Ackerman with 2020 Sports on WFAN, the flagship station for the Imus in the Morning program, weekdays from 5:30 until 10.
Three. Nice to have you aboard the Mike and the Mad Dog radio program. 718-937-6666. Two-way sports talk. Telephone number, Marvin Lewis. He runs the Ravens defense. We're going to talk to him about the offenses of both Jacksonville and Tennessee in a sec. We'll get a little preview of the AFC Championship game. Here is John Fox earlier today in the NFC Championship game, the Giant defensive coordinator. We're throwing these defensive coordinators at you because we've had so many coaches on and everything in the last two, 3 weeks to sort of mix it up. About a little bit.
Every 20 minutes, this is John Minko, WFAN 2020.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, then you're listening to Imus in the Morning. From 5:30 to 10 on The Fan, Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
Well, welcome, Mr. Thompson. I'm from Bronte Racing, who helped me fix, get the truck ready to ship out to, the guy in Rancho Santa Fe who bought it. By contributing $100,000 to the ranch. And, well, the first day started off wrong because we got We didn't get our Briante racing jacket.
What? What do you mean? How does that not happen?
I don't know.
God almighty.
But the Briante brothers are friends of Bill Cole, the Bill Cole Ford.
Oh, okay.
And so that's how we met him. Mm. And then Anthony was gracious enough to come up and help me get the thing ready to ship it by the horseless carriage people.
Mm-hmm.
You ever seen the horseless carriage trucks?
Sure. I've seen a lot of them.
Man, I mean, if you're going to ship a car someplace, you know,
it's the only way to go.
If you don't want it to get beat up.
No, that they're the experts.
Yeah.
That's all. Yeah, no, I know that.
Anyway, I'm listening to Mad Dog Russo. Mike and the Mad Dog's program is on WFAN in New York from 1 to 6 p.m. Eastern Time every day. And they've been together 10 or 11 years.
Yeah.
And the suspicion around the station has been, and there have been some evidence occasionally, that they dislike each other.
Right.
But generally, they seem to get along, don't they?
Yes, they do. Yeah.
Seem to.
Yeah. They seem to. Good point. Yeah.
And lately, they have been getting along better than they have in the past.
Apparently.
Apparently.
Yes.
Now, one of the newspaper columnists in the Sunday paper said, even though it's radio, because Francesa was off last week with the flu, you could almost see Russo delighting in the fact that he was able to do the show by himself without, probably like Mike Bell and Bo Bockfield down in Atlanta, when the bald-headed weasel, Steak Shapiro, is not there. So, and Steak is doing sports with us here in New York today and tomorrow, and I'm sure much to their dismay is insisting on flying back to Atlanta today to do
the damn show,
and then coming back here tomorrow.
What?
What?
Sure. Never leave that opening. You leave an opening like that, look what happened to, who was it, Doug Flutie?
Yeah.
Let Rob Johnson get that one little opening. Next thing you know, he's not starting the playoff game.
Yeah. But I mean, don't you kind of own the station or run it or something?
That's not an issue. That's not an issue here. I mean, it's Super Bowl week in Atlanta. The world is converging on our fine city.
Yeah.
And I need to be there. It's afternoon drive, Sports Talk Radio, Atlanta, Georgia.
Why do you need to be there?
I'm a crucial ingredient in that program.
Not according to Mike Bell and Bo Bond.
No,
I
mean,
you can imagine if they got a call about Steak, how they'd turn on him. But listen to this. Listen to this call
this
from Saturday.
Pretty shocking.
When Russo is hosting the show himself. And it was a call about Mike.
There's Mike in the car phone. Mike, how are you?
Christopher, how are you?
Fine, Michael. What's happening today?
I got a question for you. Do you think now with Gro coming in, is that enough for your business partner, Mike, to stop referring to the Jets as we and start calling them they again like they were before Parcells was there?
Mike, why are you asking me that?
I've been listening to you guys for 10 years, and at the beginning of your run, I really tuned in to hear Mike, or Mike was the one that I preferred to listen to. And this is, you know, I want to compliment you on a complete role reversal, because every person that calls in, your partner has a condescending tone.
I'm
sorry, Chris. It's the truth. I'm complimenting you. You do a better job now.
Well, listen, I'm not looking for who does a better job. I mean, I'm not looking for that. Just doing a talk show. I mean, what do you want me to tell you? I mean, I can't. I'm not going to. Mike's been my partner for 11 years. What am I supposed to do? I mean, you got a problem with Mike? You got to tell it to Mike. Let's put it this way. The pressure will be off Mike now if Gro's the head coach. How's that? Is that fair to say? I mean, I think Mike was in a very tough spot there for a long time. That spot should no longer be there for him. So from that standpoint, he's in a much easier situation. And that will make everybody's lives easier.
Yeah.
Make Mike's life a lot easier, make my life easier, and make the fans' lives a lot easier.
What am I supposed to do?
That's the worst statement of that whole thing.
What am I supposed to do? How about defending him?
You're supposed to stand up.
Yeah, how about saying, you're way out of line. Mike's not condescending to anybody. What's the matter with you, you moron?
He agreed with the guy.
Yes, absolutely.
Basically, he agreed with him.
Yeah.
And his first comment, why are you asking me that? Instead of saying, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, so even, by the way, Bernard had a good point. Even if it's true.
Well, of course. Encouraged it. I would say encouraged, if I can be so bold. Encouraged the phone call. May have planted it, even.
Mm-hmm.
I would be surprised.
Yep. Steak Shapiro making the observation.
Well, they're not wrong, either.
Could have very easily planted that call.
Yeah. Right. I would not be surprised. I've been known to do the same work on my way up.
No way.
Whatever it takes.
Why are we not surprised that you would pull something like that?
Working so far.
Yeah.
I'll put a wig on. I'll do anything to it.
Oh, absolutely. We know that.
Hello, baby.
I'm a in the morning.
Unbelievable. What am I supposed to do?
Make my life easier.
How about defending your partner?
Time for another...
Police bullets.
Here now, live from Atlanta, or actually here in the studio with us, but coming to us from Atlanta, Steak Shapiro.
Can I ask you a favor?
Yeah.
Quickly. MSNBC, every time I'm even around or near, they keep showing that clip that we talked about, the wig and the pig nose and the whole thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Today I'm doing sports. It's not I have no journalistic credibility if every time I come in here all you do is show that cut with me and the pig and the wig and the whole thing.
Steak lost a bet over the World Series.
Right.
In which...
with the Yankees and the... Well, actually, I won and I let it carry over because you bullied me into it. And then I was bullied into it, and now what happened is...
Steak agreed to put on a blonde...
See, that's what they keep doing.
Dolly Parton blonde wig.
Right.
And oink like a pig.
Right.
If, in fact, he lost the bet. He lost the bet, so...
And they keep running it. And they keep running it, and they keep running it.
Yeah, right.
Constantly.
Have you ever met Boomer Esiason?
I have not met Boomer Esiason. Haven't had the pleasure.
Have you ever had him on your program?
I don't believe so, no. He's another guy who turned us down numerous times.
Like here he is now... On this program from ABC Sports on the Imus Morning Program, our friend Boomer Esiason. Good morning, Mr. Esiason.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. How are you today?
Have you ever been asked to appear on Sports Talk 790 The Zone in Atlanta?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And?
I turned them down. Why waste my time? Nobody listens to that down there anyway.
No. That's the wrong answer.
Okay, yeah, I did and I did it. What do you want me to say?
Well, I want you to say
you the truth.
Next time they ask, well, we expect you would, but I mean...
I'm figuring that we're going to be down in Atlanta all week this week, and I would imagine that they will call and ask. Is that right, Steak?
I don't know.
Well, I'm not doing it. Forget it.
What do you mean you don't know?
I was hoping Boomer could talk to us about how to build ratings, considering we're coming off the lowest-rated Monday Night Football season of all time.
No.
It's the highest rated ever. Steak, you moron.
No. It's the highest rated ever.
No, it is not.
Yes, it is. You're wrong. It's the highest rated ever.
If you take the Falcons in the 90s, which was the final game, which was the biggest bust... In Monday Night History, separate of a World Series game competition, it brought the numbers considerably down. We'll talk to Rudy Martzk of USA Today. He'll give you the numbers.
No. It's the highest rated.
I'll do my research and I will.
No. I'm quoting the New York Times. It is the highest rated edition of Monday Night Football in the history of Monday Night Football. What are you talking about?
Hey, Steak, you got to put everything into the right context here. What you're doing is you're running off with numbers that don't make any sense.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I mean?
I'll provide the data.
All right.
It is
third in prime time, the highest ever it's finished in prime time
but the
in
ratings,
the history of the show.
But ratings for Monday Night Football.
Now, wait a minute. Are ratings for everything else down or no?
It's the highest that you've placed in prime time, but it's also the lowest rated Monday Night Football.
But compared to everything else across the board?
Let's get the relativity here right. You're not helping your case to get Boomer on your show.
He wasn't coming on anyway.
Forget it, never. What is the station letters down there? What is it, 790 something? What is that?
Sports Talk 790 The Zone.
Oh, please.
I mean, why do you have to bring this up? We're trying to support Boomer.
No. I know what you're doing.
It's been the best edition of Monday Night Football in years.
Well, he's out.
Been very enjoyable.
Sports, Imus.
With our guy Boomer and Al, what's his name?
Trotwig.
Al Trotwig, yeah.
Just nonstop.
Man, what happened to St. Louis yesterday, Boomer?
They got intimidated is what happened to them, my man. The defense of Tampa Bay just took it to them. Anytime you see that many turnovers and penalties and that means the team is intimidated. And just didn't seem to me like Marshall Faulk was the same player that we had seen. It looked like he could not get away from anybody. And if they would have had any offense whatsoever, we'd be looking at Tampa, Tennessee in the Super Bowl. Scary thought.
Well, still going to be pretty good. I mean, nobody cares. People are going to watch it anyway.
There's no question. Sure. But the problem with Tennessee is they lost two valuable players yesterday to, I think, one broke an ankle and the other broke a foot. Their starting safety and their starting wide receiver, Robertson and Thigpen. So I don't necessarily know if they have enough, but the one thing I can tell you is 10 years ago, 11 years ago, we went into the Super Bowl against the 49ers, 8-point underdogs, and we Took them all the way down to the end, so you never know.
What is, by the way, the real deal with the ratings for Monday Night Football?
Well, the real deal is this, is that it is number three in prime time overall. It's the highest it's ever finished in prime time.
Right.
The overall numbers are down, but then again, so are all the other numbers throughout network television. I think a lot of that has to do with the Internet, DirecTV, satellite television, cable. You have to remember that 10 years ago, none of this stuff was here.
How'd it do last year when there were three of you? You, Dan Dierdorfer, now better?
I think it was ranked fourth overall.
But, I mean, the numbers were better, wasn't
it? I couldn't tell you. One of the reasons that they weren't happy with the numbers last year is, if you remember, we started early. I think our game started at 8:25 last
right.
year. So they moved it back to 9 o'clock, much to the chagrin and to all the people here on the East Coast. But
no.
The fact is that it's a steady primetime program, and it's highest level ever when you look at it into the context of where it is and what it is all about.
Yeah, but, I mean, don't you think the executives over there are going to be thinking, maybe we need to go back to a three-man deal?
They might. I don't know. They haven't told me anything. Who knows?
I
actually have a call into Mr. Eisner as we speak, so he hasn't called me back.
What do you think that means?
That probably means that they're going to put two more guys in there. I don't know. Maybe it could be a single man booth.
No, but I mean,
the gal's probably lobbying for a single man booth.
Do you think it's great that you put a call in and they haven't called you back?
No.
How is that good?
Well, he's got to worry. Well, I think they have other things to worry about other than who they're going to be putting in the booth on Monday night.
What, then to return Boomer Esiason's call?
I wouldn't worry about that.
That's outrageous.
Well, no, I'm not worried about it, but
I'm
I think you should.
You ought to be.
You ought to be worried about it.
Wake
for
up.
What?
You need to wake up.
For what?
Well, it's over.
Maybe it is. Who knows? You got to remember, when I was growing up, I wanted to be a quarterback in the NFL. I've done that already. I didn't want,
that was
like
good.
The last thing I thought I was going to be doing is not
that was
going into this horrible radio show.
No,
thank God this is the end. The end is here. Thank you. This is it. Contract up and over, boys.
I thought you loved this Monday
sure.
night gig.
No, I do love the Monday night gig.
Well,
it's a great gig. I'm not saying that it's not. Right. I think it's a tremendous job.
Well, why don't you see? Maybe you should hang up now and see if you can get a call in. See if you can get somebody to call you back.
It's a little bit early out there. It's 6 a.m. out on the West Coast.
Who are you trying to call?
Well, it depends. Anybody who'll listen.
No. Who are you trying to call, ABC? Because I'll bet we can get them on the phone before you do.
Don't worry. I'm not worried about it.
Boomer Esiason. Boomer, thank you very much.
Oh, it's always been a pleasure. Oh, my God.
Is this your final appearance?
Oh, please say it is.
Sonic, you have one more.
Oh, no. I got to call it next week after the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
You tell me how that helps.
For centuries, people believed the...
Leslie Stahl. You know, the only reason she's in the business today is because she was doing Nixon. Isn't that true?
No, she was not doing Nixon.
What am I saying? She was accused by doing Abe Lincoln. There's an image for you, huh? God, sleeping with her would be like having sex with Ed Muskie.
Oh, that would be fine.
Even dogs hump her leg with their eyes closed.
Oh, come on, here.
No.
Howard.
You could pull a suede glove over a laundry basket to make someone look better than Leslie Stahl. You don't think she's had some plastic surgery, do you?
Well.
She's got stretch marks on the back of her neck that look like one of those highway rumble strips. Why is she attacking you? She's on the front cover of the current Newsweek. What more she want?
No, that is not Leslie Stahl.
Between her, Mike Wallace, and Marley Schaefer, 60 minutes is like God's waiting room. I probably shouldn't be so brutal. I ease up on her a little bit, seeing as how she's in all this legal trouble now.
Well,
getting caught in that hotel room with Kevin Stevens.
Well,
no, that was not Leslie Stahl.
Well, that was a bargain basement deal, wasn't it?
She was not in a hotel room with Kevin Stevens.
Yeah, okay, you stick by that story.
This is a New York Ranger who apparently was in a motel room out of St. Louis, right?
Yep. East St. Louis, I believe.
East St. Louis.
Yeah, with a prostitute and a crack pipe.
Right.
Where we had that?
$500 for the crack.
Yeah.
I tell you what, the $500 wasn't for that crack.
Lord. It reminds me of Joe Queenan's book, If You're Talking to Me, Your Career Must Be in Trouble. And he couldn't get any, and the guy, you know, he's a big-time journalist, so, he couldn't get any stars
right
to submit to interviews. And why? Because he had hammered them all in Premier Magazine and in Movie Line Magazine, or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
And he was made an observation about Barbara Streisand playing a $500 a night hooker in some movie. And his criticism was that anybody he talked to about it figured that Tops she would go for around $85, and that would include the room. And Miss Streisand
subsequently did not
took exception to that. And Shirley MacLaine was very amusing last night in her introduction of Barbara Streisand. And Barbara Streisand was just absolutely awful.
Dreadful.
Oh, wow. God, was she tedious. I mean, just get over yourself.
Oh, well, that's never going to happen.
I mean,
that woman. That's a permanent affliction.
From the day she was a funny girl, she was just awful, screeching her guts out. Have you ever heard a Barbra Streisand record you could listen to?
No.
No, I mean, it's another Celine Dion deal.
Yeah.
I mean, just screeching her guts out, and it makes you, get over it. Just...
Oh, well.
And listen, she's so effective with brushing her hair back and the little finger. Oh, God. Did you see that, Lou?
Yes.
I mean, make you want to. I mean, even Deirdre took her headphones off and looked at me and said, oh, God, can you imagine living with her? I think the muffler guy's going through, James Brolin.
Oh, for crying.
Oh, my God.
Pass the vodka.
Was that worth it?
No, absolutely not. What is he thinking
about? How'd that ever happen?
I don't know.
Drunken Vegas.
Career move.
I want you to call Republican, if you're in New York, even if you're not in New York, they won't know where you're from. Call Republican Party State Chairman William Powers, because Governor Pataki, who's a creep, and, I mean, he's a real creep, by the way, and some of these other Republican
mucky mucks
here in New York are keeping John McCain off the ballot. Now, whether you want to vote for McCain or not really is irrelevant. In fact, you know, it is irrelevant. But he at least should be on the ballot.
Certainly.
And George Bush could simply call Powers and say, you know, let's stop all of these bogus challenges and simply put McCain on the ballot. But he has not chosen to do that.
Right.
I don't know if Mayor Giuliani could have anything to do with it, but he'd think he could have some influence. He's declined to... So they're not being fair about it. They're not being fair at all. So.
Well, Giuliani's position, though, is that McCain should be on the ballot.
Oh, it is.
He's endorsed Bush. He's one of the few people. Rudy Giuliani has endorsed Bush, but said it's ridiculous for John McCain not to be on the ballot.
Okay, good for Rudy. That's why we're supporting him.
There you go.
That's why he's our guy. As long as we don't have to spend any time with him. But we don't have to. We can elect him to the Senate, and we never have to talk to him again, do we?
No, of course
not. Have him on a couple of times a year,
and
that's
about
it.
You don't have to.
We've never had Moynihan on, because...
he doesn't get up this early.
Yeah, he's usually a little under the weather, if you understand what the I-Man's saying, at around 7:23 Eastern time in the morning. Anyway, here's the number to call Bill Powers, Republican Party State Chairman, 518. That's the area code, 518. Now, here's the number. 462-2601. 462-2601. Call him and say, hey, come on. I mean, at least be fair about
it. Yeah, wake up. Come on.
St. Cuba.
This is silly.
Yeah, make it a fair fight anyway. 18 FDM. All right, here now on the Imus in the Morning program, Walter Cronkite.
Return with me now to January 19th, the year 2000, a Wednesday. And a day like all days, filled with the events that make us wonder why there aren't more drive-by shootings. A day filled with the dumbasses that pervade our lives. We find ourselves on the set of the Fox television news program, The Edge. Host Paul Azan is in deep interview with the aging CBS 60 Minutes reporter, Leslie Stahl. The episode is unfolding as you might expect of two blondes. Zahn is packaging her questions in pure self-absorption, confirming to even the casual observer that this is a ditz who couldn't even make it on The View, a program of unadulterated inanity that includes among its principals another ditz, Joy Behar, and Star Jones, a woman whose gravitational field bends light. Our focus, a point in the discussion during which Ms. Zahn speaks of the public's loss of confidence in the press. Ms. Stahl's brow furrows, troubling, she pronounces, heartbreaking. And then opines that audiences tend to lump all media figures into a single pile. Dan Rather with non-Imus, Pat Buchanan with Peter Jennings, Brokaw with Limbaugh, and so forth. All are the media and indistinguishable in the public's view, instructs Ms. Stahl, who then, having just made reference to Imus, adds this. People who have very obvious points of view are almost always louder and more visible than the daily reporters who are out there trying to do an honest, credible job. We get thrown in with them. Well, Leslie, you are a f***ing fathead, and you really should make an effort to get over yourself. Perhaps counseling. Perhaps another facelift. Something to make you feel better, more confident, less carping and obnoxious. For indeed, it is Imus who is saddened by being lumped together with the reprobates, such as yourself, of the so-called Orthodox Press. You of the rigged exploding truck hoaxes, the Vietnam War poison gas fabrications, the Richard Jewell terror persecutions, and the hidden cameras in the curtains con. The I-Man resents being lumped in with your company of phony, pretentious, affected, self-aggrandizing, pompous blowhards who've appointed themselves arbiters of our lives.
Yeah.
Ms. Stahl and Ms. Zahn concluded that 22 minutes, 30 seconds of vainglorious mutual rump massage this way. Leslie, drawing the robes of self-righteousness even more tightly about her, pontificated thus. It is why our system works, because we get to help the public clean out things when they get scuzzy. Ms. Zahn drools an adoring reply, and that's why the two of us love coming to work every day. My God, gag me with the First Amendment. In closing, Leslie, Paula, may I offer this. If you both were truly committed to cleaning up that which is scuzzy, next interview would be conducted in a vat of summer's eve. Let us apply an old maxim.
Yeah.
Physician, heal thyself?
No.
No. In this case, journalist, thyself. Media Watch, this is Walter Cronkite. Thank you and good night.
Boom, 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 boom. Gonna shoot you right down. Right off of your feet. Take you home with me. Put you in my house. Boom, 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 boom.
I'm a in the morning.
So, And then there's been some criticism in the press of Frances's attitude and his demeanor when fielding calls from sports fans. So, and how he treats them and so on.
Yeah.
Unfair criticism, I would point out. So, because a lot of times you get morons who call the radio station asking questions about.
And Francesa doesn't suffer fools gladly.
No, not just sitting here and some moron.
No.
With, you know, just
inane. Sort of,
inane, insipid, stupid questions about hockey or Ricky Henderson or some.
Just some dumb observation.
Oh, just idiots.
Or his relationship with Bill Parcells.
Yeah.
That's true.
He doesn't need that.
No. So, Russo fields this call at about 3 or 4 minutes to 1 o'clock on Saturday, and I happen to be listening.
There's Mike in the car phone. Mike, how are you?
Christopher, how are you?
Fine, Michael. What's happening today?
I got a question for you. Do you think now with Groh coming in, is that enough for your business partner, Mike, to stop referring to the Jets as we and start calling them they again like they were before Parcells was there?
Mike, why are you asking me that?
I've been listening to you guys for 10 years, and at the beginning of your run, I really tuned in to hear Mike, or Mike was the one that I preferred to listen to. And this is, you know, I want to compliment you on the complete role reversal, because every person that calls in, your partner has a condescending tone.
Oh, Mike,
I'm sorry, Chris. It's the truth. I'm complimenting you. You do a better job now.
Well, listen, I'm not looking for who does a better job. I mean, I'm not looking for that. Just doing a talk show. I mean, what do you want me to tell you? I mean, I can't. I'm not going to. Mike's been my partner for 11 years. What am I supposed to do? I mean, you got a problem with Mike? You got to tell it to Mike. Let's put it this way. The pressure will be off Mike now if Groh's the head coach. How's that? Is that fair to say? I mean, I think Mike was in a very tough spot there for a long time. That spot should no longer be there for him. So from that standpoint, he's in a much easier situation. And I will make everybody's lives easier. Make Mike's life a lot easier. Make my life easier and make the fans' lives easier.
Almighty, I mean, that's unbelievable. Yeah.
Oh, man, I've got your back, pal of mine. I don't think so.
God almighty, what do you want me to do?
What do you want me to tell you? What do you want me to do?
You're right, but what do you want me to do?
What am I supposed to do?
Yeah.
What you're supposed to do
is defend your buddy, your partner. So you're way out of line, moron face.
Holy Toledo.
You don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Instead, yeah, you're right, Mike. Let's be honest. My partner is clueless.
I mean,
let's hope those days are over.
I want to make my life easier.
Yeah. Make Mike's life easier, my life easier, the listener's life easier.
Yeah.
Don't bother me. Call me when Mike is here, okay? Don't bother me on my program.
What do you want me to tell you? Well, good grief. Tell you that I'm in the foxhole with you, friend.
Yeah.
Holy Toledo.
I got your bag, babe.
Yeah.
Here, I'll pick up that grenade and throw it back out of here.
Jesus.
But no.
Where would I be without Mike? Now, you notice, by the way, Chris tried to interrupt him when he was criticizing Mike, until he sensed that the guy was going to compliment him, and then...
Let him go.
Yeah, he's back here a little bit now.
Well, I'm not looking for compliments. And...
Yeah, I'm not looking for who's the best talk show.
We don't care who does a better talk show there, Mike.
I mean, you got to say at that point, not am I looking... No, I don't think that's true. That's
exactly.
What you say.
Yeah, right. I think you're wrong about that. You're misreading the situation.
You know, and
there's stuff you could have said.
Mike has been very objective and...
Oh, yeah. Never diminishes objectivity.
He's a professional all the way.
Sure.
Well, let me ask Bernie and Lou this. Was any of what the guy said true?
Oh, everything
all
he said
of
was true.
Oh, absolutely.
Right on the money.
Nailed it.
You kidding?
But, I mean, that's not the point.
He sounds like a mole.
So everything the guy said was true?
Oh, sure. No. That's not what we're talking about.
Yeah, that was light.
We're talking about how he should have responded despite the truism of everything the man had.
He should have defended Mike.
Sure.
Right.
Hey, what do you want me to do about it? Call Mike.
I mean, come on.
A semblance of a defense, maybe.
Anything. Say, well, I don't think that's true. You're entitled to your opinion, but...
By the way, he didn't even have to take the call. He knew what the caller was calling about.
Right,
that's on the screen. And he said, hey, let me go to Mike on line 5 here.
That's a very
good
point.
He wants to have
point.
A Mikey?
He
all right.
knew what
okay.
was...
Oh, I didn't even think of that.
Oh,
sure.
Yeah, sure.
Good point, Bernie.
There's no way. He could easily have went to some dope on hockey or something.
Oh, that's a very good point. I didn't even realize that.
Yeah. On the screen, someone says, wants to hammer Mike. Yeah.
Well, what if the guy, who was working then? Who was screening the calls?
Well, we don't know that.
Maybe the guy said he wanted to talk about something else and then sandbag Mad Dog. Of course, they're working in delay, aren't they?
They are indeed, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, well, if all he's going to do is press the button.
Sure.
Right.
The guy's off the air.
That was a setup, clearly.
Very well,
that's very weak. Now, I didn't even think of that.
Knew the subject matter.
Come on, Bernie.
Good
job, my Bernie.
Cola wants to blush.
Very good, Bernie.
On a fan?
Bernie for three.
Right. Absolutely, sure. Bernie from downtown.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Oh, God almighty, I didn't even realize. I don't know.
Bernie from half court.
I don't even know what I was thinking about. Of course he didn't have to take the call.
Think that...